Hi guys, welcome back to GK Code Labs. In our last session of Apache Spark series, we have covered till Apache Spark async operations. If you have not seen that video and all the videos till that session, please click on that I button, or I'll also provide the links in the description below. I request you to please watch all other episodes in this series so that we can be on same page as of when you are watching this video. So next topic in this series as per official documentation is shuffle operations. So let's discuss briefly on shuffle operations. What are shuffle operations and why they are important when we talk of Spark? So as you know, we deal with a distributed data in Spark. We can use any data structures like RDDs or data frames to handle that distributed data. But anyways, we are handling a distributed data. So what is shuffle? In small explanation, as per definition, I can say the data that is distributed, in case we have to redistribute that data in some other fashion or form. The data will still be distributed, but we are distributing it in some other fashion or form, that is shuffle. Now, why we need this? What are the impact of this? That we are going to discuss in this session. So I have prepared a small data set, just very small, literally, to explain you what exactly shuffle is. Suppose we have some data for a company called PMW. We have sales data for 3 months, October, November, and December. So let's suppose for October month, let me zoom it a bit. Let's suppose for October month, these 3 series, 5 series and 7 series are, let's say you can consider it as a product. These are 3 of the many series that BMW puts on sales in India. Let's say in October month, 1000 units of 3 series cars were sold. 500 units of 5 series and 250 units of 7 series. And similar data for other 2 months. So currently you can see here is, we have key value pairs. We have a key as a product and the value as the quantity being sold for that particular product or series in this case. Let's consider we are getting all this data in one particular file. Let's say we are reading all this data into Spark. Let's say we are reading it into RDDs. So RDDs are distributed into partitions, as we all know. Apparently, I distribute all this data into 3 partitions. In my mind, I am thinking that series wise, I'll distribute the data. 3 series into 1, 5 series into 1, and 7 series into third partition. Like that, I am thinking that. But Spark by default doesn't apply any such logic or intelligence into that if the keys are same, I should put into one partition and otherwise, if not told explicitly. So what will happen is, once you read them into 3 partitions, Spark will understand, okay, I have to distribute this data into 3 partitions. But somehow when you see what Spark read and distributed the data, that pattern you see, it might be somewhat like this. Partition 1 might have some data of some other month, and 3 series and 5 series data was from October month. Partition 2 has quantity data of from all the months. You can see the color wise, you can see it has 3 series. Let me paste it here itself. Okay, so you can see partition 3 has 1 data for November month and 2 data for December month. Somewhat like the keys are not distributed equally. So this is what will happen by default. Now in case on these paired RDDs, you have to apply any function like reduce by key or aggregate by key. What will happen is, suppose I apply reduce by key. I have shown multiple examples of reduce by key. Suppose I want to add all the quantities being sold of 3 series. What Spark has to do then is take the key in entire data. This is the entire sales data that we have read from that one file, correct? So Spark will take whatever keys are similar. 3 series is a key and it needs to calculate the sum. So what it has to do is, it has to check in all the partitions, are there any data relevant to this particular key. So it has to go anyhow because it has to compute the correct result. So 3 series data is on partition 2 and partition 3 there is nothing. Okay, so at least for 2 partition it has to go to collect the data back, then only it can compute the sum. This is how actually Spark works. But what happens here is, this partition 1 and partition 2 might not be on same machine. Also, even if they are on same machine, just make a note of it, one task of an executor can work only on one partition. So suppose there is one task, it can only work on partition 1, and second task has to work on second partition. So anyways, these two cannot be computed. If we have to take a sum of that, these cannot be computed until and unless these two data for any particular key are on same partition. So that is the reason what has to be done here is this 3 series has to be taken somewhere where partition 1 lies. This is what actually has to be done. Similarly for 5 series, these 5 series and 7 series data has to be taken to one place. That is what we call the data is co-located. And once we start moving the data from one partition to other partition, that is when it starts impacting the performance. Suppose two partitions are on same machine. What will happen is, anyways, we are copying the data from one place to another place. Suppose data is there on same machine. In same machine, the data is there, but that is an RDD. Understand this. That is an RDD. That means the data is still on the memory. So it won't impact that much because data is in memory. So moving the data from one place to another place inside memory won't impact that much because a memory is fast. But consider this data is huge. So what will happen if those 3 series data have millions of rows and it has to be co-located? In that case, what will happen is the data, if that cannot be fit into memory, it will start spilling to disk, and that will be an overhead to disk IO. In case, understand another thing, suppose these partition itself are not on the same machine. They are on different nodes which are connected through a network. So in that case, that will be a network IO. So it is very expensive in case of data is huge and we incur disk IO and the network IO. So this is what you should understand, that what is shuffle, why shuffle is somewhat inevitable. You have to have shuffle some or the other way, because distributed data, in case you have to compute it together, it has to be shuffled. Now it's up to you how you optimize this shuffle. One more important point you can make a note of, that when this all shuffle is done, there is some amount of data that is persisted on your memory or disk by default, that Spark automatically stores in case of on the fly computations, and when the data is being shuffled, in that case, in case of any network IO, if there is any connection failure or something, so it should not recompute all the things. So there is a default storage while in case of shuffle. So that is a small point, just in the corner case, you should remember. And where this particular default data gets stored, this gets stored whatever directory you have mentioned in the spark.conf, spark.local.dir variable, whatever path you have given, that is the path that will be used for this intermittent storages. There are many different Spark variables that you can modify as per your requirement that are also given in this shuffle operations. In case you need any optimization different as per your requirement, what you can do is you can go to Spark configuration guide, and here you can check on shuffle behavior. In this, they have given many options where you can tweak the Spark shuffle behavior. So you can go through all this text. Just let me know in case you don't understand this. It's not feasible for me to go and run and execute each and every variable and show the difference between them, because this actually comes into play when you are dealing with a distributed data, and that happens when your cluster is distributed. And for my tutorials, maybe after some time I'll come up with a distributed cluster. As of now I am in my local, so it won't make much sense. Even if I show the difference between all these variable and configurations, it won't make much sense and much performance boost as well in a local environment. But anyways, you can go through all of them, read the description, and please let me know in case any particular word or line you don't understand. Maybe if any of them is much important to you, please do let me know. I'll try to create a distributed environment and I'll try to explain you what will be the best and how much difference that configuration is going to make. So thank you guys for watching this video. If you liked it, please hit that like button, and please subscribe to my channel if you have not already done.